Our story started when 150 kids were told they were dumb, they were stupid, and they were nothing. And when you are told you were dumb and stupid and nothing again and again and again, so often by so many people, tragically you start believing it. So I had 150 students who, since they were 5 years old, entering into kindergarten, who felt different, who didn't have the right words, who didn't know how to use their voice, and from that early age felt that they should be invisible and on the fringe, and they didn't matter. And that script in their head kept reminding them, you're not supposed to make it. So by the time they got to my class at the age of 14, they had seen friends die, maybe a father locked in a cell or a prison. They walked through the streets that had just had a riot. And in our city, in our community, we had a horrific riot in the early 90s. And it was my students at the age of 12 and 13, who were so angry, angry at the system, angry at education, angry at the world, that they reached for a Molotov cocktail and threw it at a building. They reached for a rock, they reached for a handgun, they reached for a fist, they reached for something so that they could go through life swinging. And all of that destruction followed them into my classroom. At the age of 14, all of those words, dumb and stupid and nothing, and a world that reminded them every single day, you're not supposed to make it, became their narrative. So at the age of 14, they did not think they were gonna make it through a week or a day or even a month. Certainly not finish an entire year of high school. Certainly not graduate. And the idea of aspiring to higher education and a university was unheard of. For a lot of my students, their parents dropped out of school in elementary school. Maria's dad dropped out when he was 11, her mother when she was 7. So for most of my students, they cared about survival, getting from point A to point B. So when I walked into that classroom on that first day, I was wearing polka dots and pearls, and I was perky and annoying and a cheerleader from hell. And my students looked me up and down and thought, who is this crazy lady? Where does she come from? How do we make her go back to where she came from? Because there's no way in the world that she's going to make it. Because they were miserable. And I think their entire purpose was to make me as miserable as they were. And they did a really good job. What also struck me, in America, we have a doctrine. We have a Supreme Court that said separate is not equal. So our schools are supposed to be a gathering point where people can come together and learn equally. That Brown versus Board of Education doctrine is in the highest court. But in my classroom, my students didn't understand what that meant. So they separated themselves. And they separated themselves into comfort zones that were based on race or religion or the side of the street they came from or this zip code or this gang. And so there were all of these corners based on differences. And I looked out into this sea of differences. And all I wanted my students to do was to put down that fist, put down that rock, put down that gun, and pick up a book, or pick up a pen. And through writing, maybe we can right wrongs. Through writing, maybe we can write different endings to a different narrative, to a different story. But at the age of 14, my students weren't ready to let me in. They weren't ready to pull me closer. It's easier to push somebody away when you've been hurt, when you've been abandoned. So I was looking out into a sea of students who were damaged and wounded. And I had to figure out a way, how do I reach them? How do I make things relevant? It certainly wasn't on that first day, and it certainly wasn't with my syllabus, because I passed it out. It got to the very back corner where that gentleman is sitting. A student of mine named Darius took one look at it, folded my syllabus into a perfect paper airplane, threw it right back at me, stood up and said, why do we have to read books written by dead white guys in tights? That was his introduction to Shakespeare. In his mind, Shakespeare wasn't going to leap out of the pages of a book and have his back or put food on that table for that hardworking mom, because no matter how hard she worked, she was going to come home every day with calluses and blisters. She was going to return to that tiny one-bedroom apartment in that housing project and try to shoo away those roaches and those rats. Maybe the lights would be turned off. Maybe there wouldn't be any food in that fridge. Maybe they'd get that eviction notice again. So in Darius's mind, how was Shakespeare and that iambic pentameter supposed to help him survive? to help that mama, to help put food on that table. So on that very first day, I realized I have to figure out who my students are, where are they coming from, what do they know, what is their story. And I thought if I just pass out a journal and tell them to write, maybe they'll tell me about that dad who is rotting in a maximum security San Quentin. Or maybe they'll tell me about that social worker who comes to their house week after week. Maybe they'll tell me about those cuts and those bruises. So I passed out these journals, and on that first assignment, I said, I don't care about spelling, I don't care about grammar, I don't even care about punctuation. I just want you to write. Well, my students weren't ready to write. They weren't ready to tell me their story. A young girl walked in, and she didn't come and hand me a shiny red apple. She didn't skip, she wasn't excited. She walked in on that very first day wearing an ankle monitor because she had been arrested and was on house arrest. She had a black eye. She received a few days earlier when she left juvenile hall, and she had a probation officer standing in the corner of my classroom. And so I looked at this girl, and I wanted to know about that ankle monitor, about that probation officer, about her time in and out of cells. But she wasn't ready to tell me that story. So she picked up her pen, and she wrote, I hate Erin Gruwell. She actually wrote it twice. I hate Erin Gruwell. And if I wasn't on probation, I would probably shank her. And then a big exclamation point. So at least she got the punctuation right. And at that moment, I realized if I can't encourage my students quite yet to tell me their story, how can I get them to show me their story? So the first thing I want to do is I just want to show you a small clip. For 20 years, I have been with these students. And I met some fabulous students in Jerusalem on Sunday morning, and they had just seen a version of the feature film. And there was a sassy little 16-year-old sitting in the front row. And when I walked in, this sassy 16-year-old kind of gasped, and then she said, oh my God, I thought you were supposed to be much older, which felt really good because I was feeling very frumpy that morning, and she made me feel like younger, which is ironic because the flip side happens in America. When I usually walk into a classroom, Americans like to remind me that I'm much older than Hillary Swank. Yeah. So I guess this Israeli girl was very kind to me. But before there was a movie, before there was a book, what I wanted to do is, if you look at this room and there's nothing on the walls, what I wanted to do was to keep mementos and a legacy of what I knew my students did not have, even Anne Frank in that attic, put up posters and pictures and was able to bring that attic to life. So I wanted to bring my classroom to life. Like if you go off to the university and live in a dormitory, sometimes you just take a piece of you. The reason I wanted to bring that classroom to life is I realized that most of my students were so transient, had moved so many times that they didn't have anything that felt permanent, nothing felt like home. I had one student who you'll meet through this process who had been to 42 foster homes by the time he was 14 years old. And each and every time the social worker came to gather him, they told him, you have 2 minutes, get your stuff. And when you're 10 or 11 or 12 years old and you have 2 minutes, you throw everything you have into a paper bag. And so you start feeling like trash because everything you own is trash. So my students didn't have photos. They didn't have mementos. They didn't have home movies. So I just started taking pictures and putting them on the wall. I started bringing in my video camera and just trying to capture those moments. And all these years later, we found that we had hundreds of photos and hours of film footage. So my students wanted to do something with that amazing testimony to our 20-year journey. So we just finished a documentary. And when I was able to let the State Department of America know that we just finished it, they said, great, you're going to Israel. I say that because this film is not even released in America yet. It's not going to come out until September. But the embassy said, we are going to translate it. And they translated the film into Hebrew and Arabic. And 10 different, this is my 10th presentation, I get to stand in front of teachers and students and have moments of humanity. I get to have moments where people are empathic and we believe in something bigger. We see past culture, we see past country, and we see kids. Kids for who they can be, who they want to actualize, And over the last few days, I have met the most amazing people. The most amazing. I met someone last night in Haifa. I talked about Hilary Swank was chosen because I loved her film, Boys Don't Cry. I loved that she was gritty enough to play a transgendered youth who was murdered for living her real truth. At the end of my speech, there was this long line of college kids who were about to be teachers, and this beautiful boy, absolutely stunningly beautiful, stood there, and he was nervous, and he was kept walking away, and then he'd come back, and he'd walk away, and he waited to be the last person to talk to me, and he said, I want to thank you for choosing Hillary. I said, I know, isn't she? She's great, isn't she? He said, you know that movie, Boys Don't Cry? I said, yeah. He said, that's my story. He said, I'm going through transition. I want to be a teacher. And I'm scared to death. Because will my kids accept me? And we just kind of stood there and we kind of cried. And I said, who knows? And he said, you know. And while he was talking to me, there was these two beautiful men who were also in his class. They were also planning to be teachers. And they heard everything he said. So we made a little circle, and I said, here's a network. I want you to exchange phone numbers, become friends. I want you to help him out. That happened last night. I went to a beautiful after-school program today where they collect young people in a park who are homeless, girls who are selling their soul and selling their body and selling something to survive. And I talked about my new friend, and then immediately afterwards, another woman came up to me and she said, I want to help him. I work with transgender youth. Can you tell him to call me? Can you tell him that I'm here? Can you tell him it gets better? So that is what happens when a community of people who want to do good come together and see the world as it should be. And that's what we're going to talk about tonight, the world as it should be. It's going to happen with us. It's going to happen in a classroom. It's going to happen when we bring the world into our classroom and then the classroom out into the world. It's going to happen when women like Betty, who have a story to tell, say, I'm going to be your teacher for the day. You sit down. Take a rest, because I know the story better than you do. So what I'd like to do is I'd just like to show you a brief trailer of that 20-year memento, those faces, those names, those beautiful souls who put down that fist, put down that gun, picked up a pen, and just like Anne Frank, left a legacy, told a story, tried to create a movement. I wasn't even sure coming to Israel if anyone had ever even heard of the Freedom Riders. And I need to see your book. A woman right here not only has my book, it is signed by Darius, by Sonia. So you're going to meet Darius, and you're going to meet Sonia. So for a brief moment, I'm going to ask my new friend to show you this clip. It's like a message in a bottle. It came all the way from America just to you. And I thank you for that. This clip is unfortunately doesn't have the translated version. But this is just 2 minutes, and it just gives you kind of a taste of what we've been able to show the young people throughout this amazing country. I think it, when all said and done, we keep adding things to the agenda, but I think when all said and done, I will have done at least 25 presentations throughout this country. And I don't want to leave any presentation, any room, so I'm trying to imprint every single one of your faces into my heart right now, so that when I do leave, I take a piece of you with me. But what I'm going to leave behind for a moment is their faces, their names, and their story.
My brother went to jail. My mom was sick. My best friend died. We were doing shots all the time, going to parties and not coming back.
I used violence defending myself and getting what I wanted. It didn't change as I got older. It just got worse.
We were jaded and pissed off, and we were just so done with education.
I watched the teachers out and heard that banter about those kids and them. And I realized that those kids and them were a code word for the kids I had.
I didn't expect Erin to try to teach us anything. I knew that she was nothing more than a babysitter.
She's oblivious and nosy.
When it's obvious that a kid is not engaged, how can I make him want to learn?
Ms. G announced that we were in a journal.
The first 2 weeks, all I wrote was, I hate Erin Gruwell. If I wasn't on probation, I would probably shake her.
I can die today.
The whole day at school, I couldn't keep my mind off of a new gun.
I live in a neighborhood where the sounds of gunshots are my lullaby. Nothing has been the same since my parents started smoking crack. And
the first journal entries that I read was so difficult and yet so fascinating.
Take from others with no remorse.
Their writing was amazing.
The diary gave you a purpose.
It was a safe haven for me. We needed people to pay attention to what we were doing. To take our story to the nation's capital, to the Secretary of Education.
There are 150 freedom writers, and they tell their story in a book called The Freedom Writer's Diary.
I'm gonna forget, this man was very disgruntled, and he said, "What are you doing?" And one of the freedom writers said, "Because we're changing the world."
It doesn't take 150, it only takes one.
That's just the faces. So what I'd love to do is take you back into that classroom. Maria telling me she wanted to shame me. I grew up in suburbia. I didn't know what shanking was. It's not good. I hope it doesn't translate to Arabic or Hebrew. But we have a thing in America called Urban Dictionary. So when I got a lot of naughty names, I would go to the Urban Dictionary, create a cheat sheet so I knew what I was being called at every moment of every day. What I found out in those first few moments was my students had never read a book. Never. And to be 14 and never lose yourself in literature, to not sit in your dad's lap and read about parables or stories where the good guy makes it. Tragically, there wasn't a lot of men in my students' lives. It was a horrible phenomenon. In their city, in 1 year, 126 kids had been murdered. 126. And so at the age of 14, my kids were already jaded and afraid and going through life feeling like there's a bullseye right on my chest. And at any moment, I could be that target. I could be that statistic. I could be 6 feet under. And so a lot of my kids were just numb and anesthetized. And the idea of reading was never presented to them. They didn't have libraries adorning their walls. They didn't take trips to the library or to bookstores. And so the idea of finding literature that spoke to them was something that I had to do very sneaky. I realized I have to find stories that matter, that are relevant. And what are those common themes? And if my students aren't going to tell me their themes and just pick up a pen and write in that journal, then I need to be a little bit more subversive and find out what those themes are. And there's a game that, if you've seen the feature film, they do a beautiful translation of a game that I played. And I hesitate to call it a game because it is actually anything but. But when I was in college, there was a life-altering moment where I watched a young boy in Tiananmen Square stand in front of a tank. I think a lot of you probably have seen that image. And I remember watching that image and he was so determined, like he actually would move closer to the tank every time the tank actually didn't want to run him over, but it was the symbolism of I am standing up for something. And as I watched it, I realized I had never stood up for anything or for anyone. I was lucky to go to the right schools, the right universities, to play the right sports, join the right clubs, and I'd actually gone to the university thinking I was going to be a lawyer. And as I watched that young boy stand in front of that tank, I realized he was standing up for something that was so much bigger than him. And when we had the Los Angeles riots and I watched our city burn, there was this moment that I realized, I don't think I want to stand in front of a judge and jury. It's too late. I think I'd rather stand in a classroom in front of these kids. And I remember telling my dad that I was not going to be a lawyer, that I was going to be a teacher. He didn't take the news very well. He reminded me that teachers don't make any money, and that is certainly true in America. I don't know about Israel, but it is certainly true in America. And I wanted to believe that it was more than economics, that it was psychic income, if there is such a thing. And when you see the twinkle, when you see a light bulb go off, like you do in a cartoon. So I wanted to stand in front of my students. And that game, the line game, was an opportunity for me to get my students to stand, and in standing, say so much by not saying anything at all. I thought I could ask some questions that are relevant. And if I ask enough questions, they'll come. They'll come to that line. But if I'm really honest, I have to start with the questions I know they know, which all teenagers know, which is everything outside of education, everything outside of that classroom and curriculum, which is pop culture. The hour upon hour that they play video games, that images are live and in 3D, jumping off a screen. Or the hour upon hour they watch television, or if they sneak into a movie theater and images kind of leap off a screen, those Marvel characters. Or this song, or this artist. I got a kick out of my cab driver when I was in the Old City in Jerusalem. We were driving to the Western Wall, and he said, "I was here when all the traffic stopped because Kim Kardashian and Kanye West came to the Armenian Center," and he knew everything. He knew Baby Noor. I was very impressed by my cab driver. You better believe our kids know every moment of pop culture. That is their escape, that is their reality. So I realized those are the questions I gotta start with. I can't go for questions about reality yet. I gotta ease into them. So the first few questions had to be about this song or this artist or this icon or this movie. And I think when I initially explained the rules, we're gonna stand on opposite sides of the room, here's this tape in the center, I'm gonna ask questions and you come. The first question was about Snoop Dogg, who's actually from Long Beach, who is this hip-hop artist that every single student wanted to become. They wanted to actualize their dream of being a hip-hop artist. So when I asked those first few questions, I think my students thought, this woman is certifiable. This woman is crazy. Why is she asking questions about music that have nothing to do with English or education? But at least we're not sitting at a desk. At least we're not taking a test. At least we don't have a number two pencil in our hand. Let's go. And so they came. Question after question, they giggled, they came, they did fist bumps, high fives, they rolled their eyes, and she's loony. But enough times and that line became that gravitational pull that the questions became real. Stand on the line if you know someone who is poor. And every single one of my kids stood on that line. And it wasn't just someone, that someone was them. Because every single one of my kids was poor. Every single one of them knew what it felt like in the pit of their stomach, what it felt like to be hungry. To open up that fridge and there's nothing there, or those cupboards. To try to turn on the lights and the electricity's been turned off again. To try to take a hot bath and the gas has been turned off again. To try to get a little bar soap and wash out your jeans maybe once a month, just so you can feel clean, just so you could feel whole. To want things, to wish for things, to cross your fingers and want those jeans, those shoes, that video game, for this birthday or this holiday. And knowing if I get those jeans or those shoes or that video game, what is my hardworking mom gonna have to sacrifice? What is she going to have to go without for those jeans, for those shoes, for that game? So in that moment, as I looked up and down that line, and they were different shapes and sizes and colors and hues, they were much more similar than they were different. And I realized I can continue asking them questions. And if they're courageous enough, they will come. Most of the questions I asked were generic about someone. And then I asked a question, and I should have phrased it differently. But it was very specific. And I just said, stand the line if you have ever been homeless. And out darted Sue Ellen. If you have the book. My Sue Ellen. And she went to that line like she had done on every other question about Snoop or movies or every other question. I think she wanted like primetime real estate on that line. It was getting kind of crowded. And she got there like she had done every time. And then she got there and she realized, I am all alone. And I watched her look at her feet. And I think she wanted the floor to swallow her whole. I think she just wanted to disappear. I think she thought in her head, hurry, ask another question. I just want to go back to the wall. I don't want to be seen. I don't want to see them, and I don't want them to see me, because if they see me, they're going to see my story. And if they see my story, they're going to know. They're going to know that I'm that girl that doesn't know where I'm going to sleep tonight. And they're going to know that I don't know what I'm going to eat today. And I sit in class every single day fidgeting because I don't have clean clothes. I haven't had a shower in a month. And that story played in her mind like a movie. Not one like on a machine that we could stop or pause, but a movie nonetheless. And as she stood there looking at her feet, not wanting to acknowledge anyone or anything, suddenly out of nowhere came this beautiful girl with these bouncing braids, Tiffany. And when I'd asked that question originally, Tiffany told me she took a deep breath and walked backwards. She wanted to get closer to that wall. She wanted to get as far away from that line as she could. And she saw Sue Ellen standing on that line all alone, and she realized, that is my story. So unlike Sue Ellen looking at her feet, and unlike Sue Ellen who just wanted to disappear, Tiffany walked to that line, and she looked at every single one of us. She wanted us to see her. She wanted us to see her because she knew that if we saw her, we'd see her story. And we had. We had seen her every day. At the age of 14, this little girl would stand on the corner of the busiest street in Long Beach, 14 years old. And she stood there with a cardboard box. And she'd taken a marker from her art class, and she wrote in these big, bold letters, "We'll work for food." And she stood there. And as she stood there, she looked at every single person that passed her by, hoping that they would see her and know that she was hungry. See her and know that she was scared. See her and give her a few coins so maybe tonight she could give them to her dad and they could get a motel, that flea bag motel. And she stood there for hours. And people clutched their pearls, they grabbed their purse, they crossed the street. They didn't want to see her because they didn't want to see her story. And she said that she would stand there hour after hour, and when she finally had enough coins, she'd give it to her daddy, hoping tonight we're going to get that motel. Maybe all six of us can stay in one bed, head to toe. Maybe for the first time we could have a hot shower. Maybe for the first time I'm not going to be so scared. And that little girl would give that daddy those coins, and he would smoke it in a crack pipe. So at the age of 14, that little girl was out on that street every single day. And yet she was standing on this line in this classroom. And I looked at her, and I didn't know that story. How could I know that story? I just saw her standing on a line. But she was so regal. She was so courageous. It's like she owned her story. And in owning her story in that glorious moment, out came Narada, this beautiful boy that just wanted to fit in. Just wanted to be a teenager and play ball with the boys. Just wanted an identity. And he would be damned if anyone was going to know that he too was homeless. Because he was struggling with the idea that it's my fault because I'm always asking my mom for those things she can't afford. I want those jeans. I want that video game. And now we're homeless, so it must be my fault. And he stood by Sue Ellen, and he stood by Tiffany, and he stood there, and he owned his story. And at that moment, I knew, this is going to change that game. I might not know their story now, but I need to make this classroom a safe space. A safe space where these kids can heal, where they can tell their story, that it's cathartic, and purge it, figure out a way to write a different ending to a very different story. And so I realized with every question that I asked afterwards, those kids would keep coming. Questions about abuse, questions about alcoholism in their families, questions about drugs on the streets, question after question after question. The last question I asked my students, I was not prepared for the answer. I asked my questions to stand in line if they knew somebody who'd ever lost their life to senseless violence. Every single one of my kids stood on that line. Every single one of them. And Darius made a comment. Darius said that he felt like he lived in an undeclared war zone because he was 14 years old and he'd already buried 24 friends. 24. And in burying those 24 friends, there wasn't any nightly news show. There wasn't newspaper articles or obituaries written about them or magazine covers. They were just another nameless, faceless kid at the wrong place, at the wrong time, with the wrong color of skin. And I thought about that idea of an undeclared war. And when that bell rang and my kids left, I thought, I don't want those kids going back to that corner. I don't want them going back to that handgun. There's got to be a different way. How can I teach kids that they can fight a good fight with words and not weapons? So I started thinking about this idea of young kids who actually lived in a war and used words to fight back. Anne Frank, or Elie Wiesel, or a young girl in Bosnia-Herzegovina by the name of Zlata Filipovic. So I went to the chair of my English department and said, is there any way that I can use these books written by and for and about kids? My kids have never read a book before, and I wanted to start with Anne Frank first. And I was told by the chair of my English department that my kids would never read a book from cover to cover because they were too stupid. And I thought about those words. I thought about what we tell our kids, those labels, those stereotypes. So without really thinking it through, I just got in my car and I drove to a bookstore and I ordered 150 copies of The Diary of Anne Frank. 150 copies of Night, 150 copies of Zlata's Diary. Watched that cash register ring up those books and panicked. And I thought, oh my God, I've just used up all of my Visa, my student loans, my Christmas. I have just maxed out everything. How can I convince kids who've never read a book to pick them up and not go get a movie first, not go on the internet and download somebody else's paper, but to actually find themselves? So I decided that we were going to play another game that was anything but, and it was a toast for change. I thought, if I can just encourage my students to start over, wipe the slate clean, that maybe doing bad things doesn't mean you're a bad person. And so I decided we were going to have this toast for change, and I wanted to steal a cue from a friend of mine who was a kindergarten teacher, because I just believe kindergarten teachers are much more fun. And we actually went to an elementary school today, and I was confirmed that kindergarten teachers are much more fun. And their bulletin board is much more sexy than my bulletin board is ever going to be. But I thought, I'm going to take it back old school, back in the day when they had show and tell, because my kids missed out on that show and tell. For a lot of them, they didn't have anything to show. Or for a lot of them, that proud mama told them, don't you dare tell. So I thought, we're going to make it back in like the days of kindergarten, where there's balloons and there's posters. And I made some silly signs. I blew up some balloons. I went and got plastic champagne glasses and sparkling apple cider. Took out all the chairs. I wanted to have this kind of party atmosphere. And I wanted my kids to, for the first time, find their voice. For the first time, start over. Didn't matter that they had a 0.5 GPA. Didn't matter they'd been kicked out of every school they ever attended. Starting right here, right now, we're going to start over. My students walked in like they did with a line game. I thought, oh God, here goes another one of her silly games. I think it was Maria who kind of rolled her eyes and went, oh, Miss G, stop going to Starbucks, because clearly you've had way too many lattes. And I was hoping that they would do some kind of toast to academia, to that test, or that perfect book report, or that perfect essay. But when given the opportunity to toast to something, it was far more fundamental than a book report or a test. And Maria picked up that plastic champagne glass, got very serious, and she said, I don't want to be pregnant by the time I turn 15 like my mama. And I don't want to spend the rest of my life behind bars like my daddy. And I don't want to be 6 feet under by the time I turn 18 like my cousin. I want to change. And here was this tough little girl with an ankle monitor and a black eye and a probation officer and a rap sheet. And she wasn't so tough. And in that moment of being weak and vulnerable and exposed in front of a room full of her so-called enemies, every single one of those kids, every single one of them, just wanted to be heard. Darius stood up and he said, I'm tired of being asked to act like a man, and there's no man in my house to show me or to guide me. And then Henry stood up and he said, I'm tired of sitting on the edge of my bed on this Christmas or this birthday, waiting for my deadbeat dad to show up and bring me a present or tell me he loves me. And he never shows up. My kids were tired. They were tired of being poor. They were tired of being picked on. I think they were just tired of being tired. And in that moment, there was a part of me that panicked, and I thought, I'm not a counselor. I am not a therapist. I don't even know how to work the copy machine yet. I don't even know how to work that machine yet. How am I supposed to help these kids change? And if I can't, maybe my girl Anne Frank can. And I gave them the book. And so what I wanted to do is I wanted to show you another clip that I think is really special. And the reason it is so special is when they were able to bring this story to life, it was so important for my students that the screenwriter use their words as their muse. Go to the source. Go to our book. Talk to us. Don't go out and hire Hollywood hotshots. Whatever you do, don't hire Miley Cyrus. Please. So we made it a ploy that we were going to hire real kids that were not actors, you know, kids that struggle or have acne and body issues and are kids. So the young boy that you're going to see in this next scene, you're never going to see him in any Hollywood movie. He's never going to be on the cover of some magazine with, you know, some chiseled abs or any of that stuff. The young boy who's actually going to read this journal was homeless, as was the writer. And the writer of this journal wasn't some hotshot in those Hollywood hills. It was a 14-year-old boy who stood on a wall, and he watched Sue Ellen. And then he watched Tiffany. And then he had the strength to join them. And after he stood on that line, he went to a shelter, and he picked up a pen, and he wrote a story, not knowing that it would be Diary 24 in your book, not knowing that it would be a moment in time, but the power of words. So every single word that this young boy says was written by my student, Narada. So for a brief moment, I'm going to ask you once again to help me pull up this clip, this beautiful moment of my students picking up a plastic champagne glass and making a toast. They just wanted things to be different. They just wanted things to be better. I think they just wanted to believe that change was possible.
Okay, guys, gals, listen up. This is what I want you to do. I want each of you to step forward and take one of these Borer's bags, which contain the four books we're going to read this semester.
All right.
They're very special books, and they each remind me in some way of each of you. I want you to take one of these glasses of sparkling cider, and I want each of you to make a toast. We're each gonna make a toast for change. And what that means is, from this moment on, every voice that told you you can't is silenced. Every reason that tells you things will never change disappears. And the person you were before this moment, that person's turn is over. Now it's your turn. Okay? Okay. You ready to get this party going on?
sounds like 11, you know?
Probably.
Okay. Well, I was always the person that was going to get pregnant before I turned 16 and drop out. Like my mom. Ain't gonna happen.
Nobody ever listens to a teenager. Now everybody thinks you should be happy just because you're young. And they don't see the wars that we fight every single day. And one day my war will end. And I will not die. And I will not tolerate abuse from anyone. I'm strong.
My mom's kicked me out when I got jumped into the gang life. But I like her to see me graduate. I like to be 18.
Miss G, can I read something from my diary?
That'd be great. Oh, see.
Man, he's been with us for freshman year, fool.
What's that?
I don't know.
The summer was the worst summer in my short 14 years of life. It all started with a phone call. My mother was crying and begging, asking for more time, as if she were gasping for her last breath of air. She helped me as tight as she could and cried. Her tears hit my shirt like bullets and told me we were being evicted. She kept apologizing to me. I thought I have no home. I should have asked for something less expensive at Christmas. On the morning of the eviction, a hard knock on the door woke me up. The sheriff was there to do his job. I looked up at the sky, waiting for something to happen. My mother has no family to lean on, no money coming in. Why bother coming to school or getting good grades if I'm homeless? The bus stops in front of the school. I feel like throwing up. I'm wearing clothes from last year, some old shoes and no new haircut. I kept thinking I'd get laughed at. Instead, I'm greeted by a couple of friends who are my English class last year. And it hits me, Mrs. Gruwell, my crazy English teacher from last year, is the only person that made me think of hope. Talking with friends about last year's English and our trips, I began to feel better. I received my schedule and the first teacher is Mrs. Gruwell, room 203. I walk into the room and feel as though all the problems in life are not so important anymore. I am home.
I marvel at two words, not because I'm an English teacher and I'm a sucker for alliteration, which I am, but two words that Narada used, hope and home. And if we think about that, that a kid who was 14 years old and by every stretch of the imagination could have and should have felt hopeless, because a lot of our kids do, could rally to feel hope that it's out there. It might be out of reach, but it is out there. And for a kid that is homeless to feel at home, not in that shelter, not in that hovel, but in a classroom with people that didn't look like him or talk like him or come from where he came from, but they became the brothers and the sisters that he chose, the family that he desperately needed to make. This place is permanent. This is the place I want to be. And I think about that. I think about this moment. What was so beautiful is when my students began writing their stories. They wanted to feel safe, so we came up with these rules. We tried to create these cultural norms. And we came up with all these rules that we needed to have a number instead of a name. We needed to type them in 12-point font, double-spaced Times New Roman. Everyone had to be the same, so we wouldn't know someone's handwriting. We had a vow that we weren't going to sensationalize. We weren't going to tell. And so none of these stories had a name, a gender, or even an ethnicity. So the irony is the young boy who wrote that story is African American. When they made this film, we didn't tell anybody whose story it was. So the fact that they cast a Latino boy shows the universality of storytelling. Shows the universality of other people have stories that may not look like us or talk like us. Because when I gave the book to Maria, the Diary of Anne Frank, she was so excited about the concept of changing. We just did this toast for change. She wasn't excited about changing through reading a book that was 300 pages. She wasn't excited about her homework. She wasn't excited about looking at the cover of a book of a little girl who didn't look like her or talk like her or come from where she came from. She couldn't identify Amsterdam on a map. She had never heard of the Holocaust, and suddenly she's supposed to read this book about a little girl that doesn't speak Spanish, about a little girl who's not Latina, about a little girl who is not from her hood. And yet Maria took that book home, and the saving grace on that first day was she was still in house arrest. And what that means is if you're not indoors by 4 o'clock, your probation officer picks you up and takes you back to jail. So I think she stormed into this tiny one-bedroom apartment, like 359. And the lights have been turned off again. And there was no food in her refrigerator again. And her mom was out working that third job again. So without anything to do or anyone to talk to, Maria said she reached for a candle and began reading this book and hoping she could come back and tell me I was wrong. There was no way that she was ever going to relate to this little girl. And yet Anne spoke to her. Anne spoke to her in a way by talking about using wings to fly. Anne spoke to her about her father and all of those moments that Anne wrote about. And as she kept reading this book, Maria kept projecting her gangster mentality onto sweet little Anne. And every day she'd come back and she had nicknamed the seven others in the attic Anne's posse. And she wanted to know when Anne and her posse were going to smoke Hitler and just take him out because that's what her gang would do. And I realized that it was becoming like this gangster tale. And I said, it's not that kind of book, Maria. Like, just keep on reading. As you all know, Peter develops a crush on Anne, and so Maria wanted to know when Peter and Anne were going to hook up, do a little something-something, become a little racy Harlequin romance, and I'm like, it's not that kind of book. But I love that she was drawing inferences and trying to make these comparisons, even though it was comparisons to a lifestyle that was so different than Anne's. And as many of you know, when Maria finished reading the book, it crushed her, devastatingly so. Devastatingly so, because in her mind, here was this good little girl, and this good little girl didn't make it. And in Maria's mind, she was a bad girl who had done bad things. So if this good little girl doesn't make it, there was no way in the world that she was going to make it. And I remember her challenging me and saying, I'm never going to trust you. I'm never going to read another book. And out of nowhere, Derry stood up and he challenged her. And at that moment, I realized if we teach our kids to teach one, they can teach another. Because suddenly Derry was speaking directly to her. And he challenged her by saying, how many of our friends have died, Maria, and we've never read an obituary? They're not in the news. But because Anne Frank wrote about it, she is going to go on living even after her death. And I looked at this big boy, and he had all of these books about the Holocaust, books about Anne in that attic, books about World War II. And I looked at him, and he had all of these books, and he was so proud. This was his moment for show and tell. At the age of 14, finally, I get to have my moment of show and tell. And I ruined it by saying, did you actually check those books out of the library? And he said, no. Darius had never been to the library before, so all those books were technically contraband. He shoved them down his jeans. He put them in his Raiders jacket. He had his gangster buddies lift a few, but he had done research. And in his research, he had found out that this simple woman, this simple secretary named Meep Geese, she was alive. She was alive. At that time, she was 87 years old. She was living in Amsterdam. And Darius thought, We can write her letters. We can send them to her like a message in a bottle, and she will hop on a plane, she will fly across the globe and come and talk to 150 gangsters. It's that simple. All of you educators know it is not that simple. But it became this movement, this cause, the imagination that if they could write their story and they could send it to her, that she would come. And I never planned to send those letters because I didn't dream like my students did. I was still kind of a cynic, I was still kind of a realist, but I knew that they'd write really good letters. And then my students try to do a fundraiser, and I have the poorest of the poor, kids that can't go to their moms and ask them to write checks or pull out a Visa or even go to an ATM and get a crisp $20 bill. Because the reality is if they got that $20 bill, that should go for the lights. That should go for food. Shouldn't go for some woman living across that pond. And one day, Darius put me on the spot, like kids always do. And he said, what happens if she doesn't come? And she wasn't supposed to come. And I told the group yesterday, there was something very symbolic about that day. I was feeling disappointed because on that particular day, we hadn't even reached $20. We just had 18. But I did not know the symbolism of the number 18. A Holocaust survivor taught me. So we had $18. No plan. And I said to Darius, and if we raise all this money, maybe we can buy more books, maybe we can go on a field trip, maybe we can have a pizza party, so it's a win-win, because we'll have done it together. And then I stopped myself, and I truly don't know how or when or even why. But I said to him, but if she does come, your lives will never be the same. And she came. She came. Betty knows her, knew her. Her brother knew her well. And this tiny little woman, 87 years, not as cute and feisty as Betty. Let's be clear. But this 87-year-old woman sat down and read letter after letter. There was typos, and there was grammar mistakes. She didn't care. I think she saw something in each and every letter, in each and every kid, that she must have seen in Anne in her diary. Whether it was hope or promise or possibility, she saw something. She got on a plane and she flew across that globe, regardless of their skin color, regardless of what their parents did or didn't do. She came for them. And right before she came, I think it sunk in and we panicked. We thought, oh my God, what do we actually do with her once she shows up? Like, where do we put her? What do we do? I'll never forget, we were going to host her in this really rundown community center. It was across the street from the school. And we went there and we walked in the room and it was demoralizing because every single wall was covered in graffiti, covered. And for us, it was like we were meeting an ambassador or a diplomat. And I looked around that room and I looked at my students and I realized I actually have all the graffiti artists in my class. So I went out and I got like butcher paper and like markers and pens and I said, transform this room. And they became Picasso. They transformed that room. And as they're transforming that room, out of nowhere, Darius stands up and says, we should probably feed her because plane food sucks. Not that he would even know, he'd never been on a plane. But it was this opportunity for him to offer up his grandma's mean sweet potato pie. And not to be outdone, where he's like, well, my mom can make tamales. And then Bunny stood up and she's like, well, my mom can make Cambodian rice. And I pictured for the first time my students who had hated school and hated reading and hated writing standing in a kitchen with a mama or an auntie or grandma making that sweet potato pie, rolling those tamales, stirring that rice, and talking about a little girl in that attic, bringing that book and that story to life for a mama or an auntie or grandma who didn't know that story. So once again, my kids got to become those teachers. And the next day that she came, this tiny little woman who was 4 foot nothing, you would have thought that it was Shaquille O'Neal, LeBron James, the largest basketball icon you can imagine. She was several feet shorter than them, several shades lighter than them, and yet she transformed their lives. And she told stories that we didn't know, that the book had ended, and the story continued. And the most amazing thing that she said to them was, please make sure that Anne's death is not in vain. And in doing so, I think my students felt it's our time. Let's write our story, even if it's just for us, not for a grade, not because it's a class, but let's write our stories. And that's really where this book came from, was the idea of sitting down and writing for writing's sake, and reading and finding out other stories so that we could eventually go to Shakespeare, that dead white guy in tights. So we could read about poetry by starting with what they knew. We started with, I wanted to start with Gertrude Stein's A Rose is a Rose is a Rose. I started with Tupac and A Rose in Concrete. So eventually my students were so prolific and profound that part of what we've been showing throughout Israel is a documentary that is not narrated by some hotshot Hollywood icon. The narrators of our documentary are my kids. And I think what I've marveled the most about is how eloquent they are, and articulate, and passionate. And they didn't have a script. It was all those silly vocabulary games that we played with Fruit Loops and peanuts and things that brought words to life. And eventually those words became a part of their vernacular, part of their everyday speech. So I want to show you one last clip because I think it is the most profound. It's been the most profound here in Israel. Because after my students graduated, after my students went off to college, they realized there was one last field trip we had to do, and that one last field trip was based on all of those books that we'd read. They wanted to bring them to life. Because Anne Frank stopped writing that book on August 4th. But as you know, the story continued. And so they wanted to go to Anne Frank's attic on August 4th in honor of Meat. They wanted to go to Auschwitz in honor of Elie Wiesel. And they wanted to join their new friend, Zlata Filipovic, in war-torn Bosnia-Herzegovina. And so the last clip I want to show you, we've been able to show to so many students in this country. And it's tough, and it is beautiful, and it is very compelling about conversations that need to be had about very complex subjects. I want to honor a beautiful woman in the audience who happens to be from one of the countries that we visited. She's from Poland. And we spent a lot of time in Warsaw and Krakow and went to a place called Chełmno, which was an extermination site. And you're going to see a woman who lived next to Chełmno since she was just a baby. Lived there during the war and she didn't move. And some of my students are making comments about how could she live there? How could she not do anything or say anything? And I want to say to you that I hope that didn't come across as a sweeping generality. Because when we were in Poland, we met some of the most amazing people. Righteous. Not just that woman, but people who fought and helped others survive. So when your husband said that you wanted to be very sensitive, that I want to be sensitive to that as well. And so I want to make sure that you know that when we were in your country, it was transformative. And that was just one moment, but it was a juxtaposition for us to draw parallels between what happened during the Holocaust, when people stood idly by, some, not all. And tragically, what happens in our inner city, and it has come very true about several weeks ago in Chicago, the city where President Obama was a senator, a 9-year-old boy was lured and coaxed into an alley and shot execution style at point blank range. And there was witnesses. And nobody wanted to say anything because nobody wanted to rat, nobody wanted to snitch. So the juxtaposition my students were making were to moments like that about in our country, when we stand idly by, how dare we? But the most I think important moment of this piece is my Maria. And it happened in Bosnia. And it happened when she was talking to genocide survivors who had been affected by the war personally. It was their friend who was shot. It was their father who was put in Omaskog camp. It was them. I just can't wait for you to see what Maria does. My little woman warrior who wanted to do all kinds of harm to me has learned how to channel that passion, and that passion is now about peace. So in our last clip, what I'd love to do is take you on a field trip, put you on a plane, on a bus, take you to Amsterdam, where Betty is from. I think she's gonna be very excited. She might get homesick for a moment, but I wanna take you to Amsterdam and to Poland and to Sarajevo.
That lead into the camp. When I walked through, it felt like if it was a point of no return. Well, this is the end, you know, this is where the train stopped, this is the end of my life.
I find solace here, because I find the truth here. I find the souls, I communicate with the souls.
To travel with Mel Mermelstein, who is a Holocaust survivor, and he took us back to Auschwitz to show us where his father and his brother had been killed. It still takes my breath away because Mel had moved on, but he didn't forget, and he made sure that other people knew of his story and of the other stories of people that had died and lived through Auschwitz.
To die, and that's all they did was kill people.
When the people shipped from this village were passing by, they had to close their ears in order not to hear all the screams.
The lady came out of her home, and she lived there, and she talked about how she could hear the people screaming, and she, you know, they didn't do anything. And that was what really struck me about the whole situation. About them placing these death camps in the countryside right next door to people's houses. No one did anything.
Screaming in my back.
backyard where people are horrified and dying every day. But how, you know, can I live in the inner city and hear people screaming and dying in my alley?
Can you go for a little bit?
I think that the people who didn't do anything, it was because it wasn't personally connected. And when you can make personal connections, then people start to feel things. And so having these feelings of empathy and compassion will often drive people to want to take a stand, I think.
Back to normal when we went. There were still military forces rolling around the city. There were still buildings that were shattered from missile attacks.
I wanted to go home. Just seeing all this stuff that was going on, I was like, man, what am I doing here?
We met up with Slata, and now she was showing us her town.
These town halls were brought in community members who had been affected by the genocide and by war. The most powerful town hall that we hosted was in Sarajevo.
We brought Serbs, Croats, and Muslims together to enlighten us on the war and on the issues that they had to face.
In every nation, there are some people that they are very extreme, you know, and they make war. And we make peace, and I hope that one day we will win.
During the war, I was wounded twice. How can I say, my child, you know, they wounded me. Who? My friends, my good friends, good people. I don't understand.
This guy is pouring his heart out, you know? But it wasn't what everybody wanted to hear.
That sniper will have a child also. And he will say his child. You know, Muslims are enemies. Always. You can remember that. What can I do?
At that moment that boy gets up and he talks about the sense of the fact that he can't forgive. And I felt the need to say something because I know it so well. I know it so well. And every word that he said was so familiar. And even the look on his face was so familiar because I've had it before, I've felt it before, I've said it before.
Sometimes when things get really heated, it takes a brave person to take a stand on behalf of a group. I think that person for the Freedom Riders was Maria.
I can totally relate when you say that it's hard for you to talk to people that shot your friends and shot your family. I can totally relate to you because that's the way I felt when I was 14 years old. I saw my friends, my cousins, my uncles get shot by white policemen when I was 5 years old. And I remember that like it was yesterday. And I hated white people throughout my whole life because of two cops that shot my cousin to death. I remember black people shooting my cousins. I remember Asians shooting my brother, shooting my father. But I remember Stephanie's face, and I remember Henry's face, and I remember Tiffany's face, and I remember Bunny's face, and that overweighs anything that I have ever seen in my life, that I have ever heard in my life. So when I go back to my family, I'll be damned if my father ever said anything racist about black people, Asian people, or white people. I'll be damned if any family member of mine ever said a racist joke in front of me. And that's how I'm changing my community. That's how I'm changing my family. Thank you.
My dad was a professional baseball player, and there was this moment where Babe Ruth like pointed to the rafters as if he was gonna knock it out of the park, and he hit a grand slam home run. And I feel like that was Maria's like point to the rafters. You know, I'm gonna school you. I'm gonna validate who you are and your story and where you're from, but I'm gonna knock it out of the park. And I think as a teacher, that to me is the most amazing moment. It wasn't for a test, it wasn't for a grade. she was able to do the right thing. Meep had told my students that she wasn't a hero, but she simply did what she had to do because it was the right thing to do. And I think in that moment, that was the right thing. Maria had to stand on that chair. Maria had to confront that situation and let him know there are other alternatives. There are other things that you could do. And what has been happening in this amazing country of yours, as we show this documentary, is people are now wanting to have conversations. People are now wanting to stay afterwards and say, I want to do more, I want to be more, I want to be a teacher. Yesterday was one of the most glorious moments. My new friends at the embassy, we were with a room full predominantly of young Muslims who are going to be educators. And after I showed this clip, a young Muslim woman who was studying to be a teacher, she stood up and she was mad. You could see like smoke coming out of her ears and daggers coming out of her eyes. And the first thing she said to me is, how dare you? How dare you take your kids to Auschwitz? But it wasn't about anti-Semitism. For her, she had lost her dad. And it was too painful. And so why would I drudge up all these painful moments for my kids and give them nightmares? And it became this discussion. And at first I thought, oh God, she's coming out swinging. She's pointing to her rafters. And we went back and forth. And I think at the end, we became these BFFs. Because she stayed to the very end of every hug. We took selfies. I took selfies with her. And she left and she came back and she gave me another hug. And then she left and she came back. And Reese and I were just like, did you see? That was the girl. That was the how dare you girl. It was unbelievable. It was unbelievable. So I think in that moment, I think it's important when you just validate someone's pain. I immediately thought, oh God, it's this, when it was really personal. And I was able to share with her something personal about me. Some of you may have seen the feature film, and the father in the film is my father. And the beauty of our story is my dad was always around, originally he was a lovable curmudgeon. And then he fell in love with those faces, how could he not? And he went on every field trip, you know, he went everywhere we went. And so as my students had named me Miss G, or for a lot of my orphans, Mama G, they named my dad Papa G. And Papa G became very, very cocky as this idea that Hollywood was coming a-calling. And my dad and I talked 10 times a day. He was on speed dial. My dad would call and say, so I've been thinking that Jack Nicholson should play me. Like literally, unabashedly convinced that Jack Nicholson should play my dad. And it was hysterical because at the time it was going to be like this small little indie film. And I said, Dad, we don't have that kind of budget. And then a couple days later, the phone would ring and it would be my dad. And this time, Robert Redford should play me. Like literally, I'm not even kidding. He must have spent hours upon hours casting himself. And as I told this young woman yesterday, one day the phone rang. And it wasn't my dad casting himself. It was a call that he had had a heart attack and he had died suddenly. So my dad never saw the movie. My dad never got to see this part of our journey. So I wanted that young girl to understand that there are different ways of grieving. There are different ways of sharing a legacy. And for me, it was these silly pearls, these beautiful pearls that my dad gave me. And I feel like if I wear him, I feel him. And if I feel him, he is with me. And so in that moment, we had this connection, not about religion or cultures, about two girls who are their father's daughters, who miss them. And so it became about humanity, and it became about understanding. And that is what Maria taught me, is be bold. Even when you're scared to death, she stood on a chair. It's not like standing in front of a tank in front of Tiananmen Square, but she stood on a chair. And I think for a lot of the kids that we teach, let them be bold. Let them find that voice and that story, and they're going to challenge you. Let them challenge you. For those of you that traveled 2 hours tonight, thank you. Thank you. I just hope that I did them justice. I just hope that I did that story. I just hope I'm worth that 2 hour drive, and as you're going home, you're not cussing me out. Like, oh.
And I'm not
going to
shank you.
And you're not going to shank.
That's not what it means,
right? It's not good. Sister, it is not good. So in the last few moments, I'm going to ask the ambassador's wife. I actually brought a book for you and your husband, but my hotel is right next to the embassy. And I'm going to ask you if I can give the book that I brought for you to my new friend Betty, because look what Betty came with. Betty came with her own book, Broken Silence. Oh my! That is my girl. It's four. Did you hear that? My girl. So Betty, I'm gonna give you mine, because I get yours. And I want to tell you, I've been blessed to have wonderful people like Betty in my life. We've had Holocaust survivors who have been a part of our story for 20 years. You saw Mel. Mel just turned 92. Renee and Gloria and Elizabeth, all the women that are in the feature film are survivors we see every year. We still work with them. Renee Firestone invites my kids over for Shabbat dinners and for Passover, and a lot of my students are grappling with, why do we have to eat this gefilte fish? They don't know if they like it. Do they have to? they eat it. But I had to live through the passing of a very special man, Jack Pollock, because his granddaughter is my intern and his daughter is on my board. Jack lived to be 101. He got to watch the World Cup, and he got to watch his Dutch team, he was dressed in orange, kick Spain's butt. But it was hard. And I've watched Sophie and Margaret grapple with a world without him. Absolutely. Can Betty say a few words? I think, can you stand up here? You have earned that right.
Just because I have to explain something, otherwise everybody's asking me, what are you having here? What is this German flag? Oh, give me a hand.
Okay.
I'm standing here.
Okay. Okay. Much better, right? Can you all see her?
I want to explain something. I'm performing almost all the time in Germany. In Germany, there they really strive to give all the children an idea of what has happened in the war. And there I perform twice a year, about a whole week, in six different towns, six different big schools, and I do it already 6 years, and I hope to perform. They asked me until 100, I said maybe 110. But there isn't other Germany now. It's a bit difficult here in Israel to explain that I am happy and proud to have received this honor, which is the highest honor in Germany they can give to people. And I got it 2 weeks ago in Germany. From the president, Gauk, a very fantastic man, and I heard that he is coming very soon to visit Israel as well. And I hope once to meet him, because this man has also been in a position to be invited to the Netherlands 3 years ago on the 4th of May, when we all are in a very special, well, special mood. That is the day of remembrance. And especially for us Jews, it's very different day, very different, and he had to speak. I know from a very good friend of mine who had to take him around that he was so nervous and so afraid as a German to be able to have to speak that day, that she told me about it, that I, before he had to enter, I unarmed him. And I said, go in, it will be wonderful. It was also like that. So there is an other Germany at the moment. Just today, I spoke a friend, a woman who I help with a lot of things. She comes from Hungary. She lost all her family, a wonderful person. She cannot talk about the Holocaust, but I help her, I can help her, because she is not in a position ever to go to Germany or to speak a word of German. But for those people, I can be there. I went to Germany because she was invited. They want to make good to the people, but people who really survived find it so difficult, they don't want to go. My brother and his wife never set a foot in Germany and never could go there, but for me it was different. I survived the Netherlands because, well, just a few words about how I speak to the young people, because I always start to tell them, I want them to be about 16 or 17 or 18. When they are younger, it's a bit difficult. I always start to tell them when I was 16, how did I react to this terrible man, Hitler? I said, there was radio then. No, there was no, what do you mean that now? It was only radio. I listened to the radio, and the whole family said, close that, we don't want to hear it. I don't know why I was so different, because I said, we have to hear it. We have to know what this man is crying out into the world, because he is crying out, Jews are the rats of the world. They all have to be eliminated. And they said, well, these are just words. That's the way I talk to the children, because just words. Do you listen, any of you, to the football fields, what they cry out? When there is someone of another color, someone of another religion, what are you thinking then? Are you trying to act against it? And I said, that's what I wanted to do when Hitler was there. That is the way I can, well, come together with them and with all the stories. And I'm so happy to do it. I can talk for 2 hours.
Well, let me ask you a question. If these are your brethren and you don't have to get on a plane and fly to Germany, would you go and talk to some classrooms? Would you talk to some classrooms if they asked you? They want you to come to their classrooms.
It happened to me in Bonn. They were so full of people, and I was talking and talking, and I didn't look at my watch. And all of a sudden I said, wow, almost 2 hours I've been speaking. There is no room anymore for anyone to ask a question. And there was one boy who already sat like that. And I said, so one question. Well, that boy had a question which I really want to be. You are standing all the time. Yes, I want to stand. I want to look everyone in the eyes. You're standing all the time. You are speaking all the time. You must be dead tired. I said,
I tell you, no. You are all very tired because you gave me so much energy that I can go on another hour and you have to go home because you have to go home. That's the way it is.
Oh, man. Let me help you down. She's a big flirt, too. I think she's a cougar with that German president. I don't know. I can't confirm or deny. What an amazing night. And I'd love to, if there's any last comment or question, she just rejuvenated my spirit. And I hope that you reach out to her. She's here. Hip. Stylish. And I'm going to honor this. So in honor of this amazing country, these amazing kids that you get to see each and every day, tomorrow is Israeli Day of the Teacher. So this is really about education. And it's about our profession. And all of you that are teachers are going to be really tired tomorrow morning. It's not my fault. It's Betty's fault. It's Betty's fault. But in honor of all of us, we are all in this together. We are kindred spirits, and I like to believe that I'm just an ordinary teacher who had extraordinary kids, and I just am so proud to share their story and their legacy. And for those of you that have the book, I can't even tell you the kind of email that I get to write to them tonight. Because every night I've been going to my towel, and Sumon, who was homeless, is actually staying at my house this week and watching my dog. Oh. And Tiffany is jealous because Tiffany wants to stay there. So every night I go back and I get to email Tiffany and Sumon and all the students I talked about. Narada sent me the most beautiful email on the plane. He said, we're all praying for you. We're all thinking about you. Take us with you. So that's what I get to do is write in my journal and write in my email that a teacher had a book signed by Darius and Sonia, that somebody drove 2 hours, that we got to meet an ambassador's wife who was a teacher, who was one of us, that I got to hang out with Betty, who was cooler than cool, and all of you. So I really want to thank the U.S. State Department for saying come, for translating our film, for planning the most amazing, I don't even want to go home. I really don't. So I want to thank you. Reese has been trying to hydrate me because I just cry so much that she's like, you need to drink more water. There's like 18 bottles up there. It's like. So I hope all of you are hydrated. I hope all of you are so proud of this profession, this noble profession, where we get to teach one to teach another every day, every moment. May our classrooms be what we make of them. Our teacher friend gets to be a teacher with every single diplomat, every single person who comes to this country. You're still that teacher. You are, with every conversation you have. So even if you are not a classic teacher, be a teacher in your own special way. And as Meep Geese so eloquently told my students, may you turn on a small light in a dark room. And I think that's what's illuminating this room. There is so much light, there is so much passion, and I thank you for letting me be a part of that. Thank you. Thank you.